As of today, the Winter Olympics are underway in South Korea. University of Richmond law professor Andy Spaulding recently completed extensive research concerning anti-corruption law as it relates to the Olympic Games, and he's here with us today to talk about that research and what it reveals. Good morning.
Morning.
It's already an educational thing for me. I misspoke. I said Pyongyang. It's actually Pyeongchang.
Right, right.
And there's a major difference.
A major difference indeed, yes. We should be glad that the Olympics are in Pyeongchang and not Pyongyang, which is the capital of North Korea.
Mm. Right. And this Olympics is unique in that there is a unification team from North Korea and South Korea.
That's right.
What can we extrapolate from that? Are we seeing maybe some warming of relations there?
Oh, I think we certainly are. Remember that when South Korea first hosted the Olympics in 1988, North Korea boycotted. Right? Now, 20 years later, we see the women's hockey team, joint hockey team between North Korea and South Korea. We see the two teams marching under a common flag. And so that really does show that North Korea and South Korea are starting to reach out to each other. Meanwhile, North Korea is very hostile to the United States. But that's really about problems between North Korea and the U.S., not between North Korea and South Korea.
Mm, so something we'll need to watch as athletes come together with good sportsmanship, hopefully, through this. You did this research concerning anti-corruption law and the Olympics. Exactly what does that mean?
Sure. So for the last several years, we've had major corruption stories around the Olympic Games, whether it's Sochi, Russia, and $50 billion embezzled, or Brazil and South Korea. We've seen presidents impeached and major prosecutions. But what people don't appreciate so much are the underlying cultural and legal changes that are occurring in these countries and at the level of the International Olympic Committee that are designed to address corruption. So we're discouraged by the corruption that's being revealed, but we should be encouraged by the measures that are increasingly occurring and implemented to address this corruption.
Mm-hmm. One of the things I was even reading was sometimes there's corruption surrounding simply the choice of what city's going to host Olympics.
That's right. And that form of corruption really blew up about 20 years ago with Salt Lake City in the 2002 Winter Games. There was a major bribery scandal. We've been addressing that ever since. In the last 5 years, we've seen a different kind of corruption, which is corruption within the host country, where corporations and businesses are engaged in corruption in the business of preparing for the games once they've been awarded. So there's a 7-year gap between the awarding of the games and the games themselves. In that 7-year window, lots of things can happen, some good, some bad.
Mm-hmm.
And increasingly, the International Olympic Committee is recognizing there's a problem here with host country corruption and is adopting new measures to try to reduce that corruption and make the games honest and transparent and competitive.
And you were in South Korea last year. You're headed back next week, I understand.
Right. Yes.
What is your field of study when you're there?
Yeah, so South Korea has adopted a number of major legal reforms in the last few years. So too are they going through fundamental cultural changes in that country related to corruption. For example, South Korea is a major gift-giving country. Gifts were used to show respect or affection. Well, a new anti-bribery law has been passed in South Korea, which prohibits gifts to many different kinds of public officials, including teachers, including the media, I'm sorry to say.
Mm-hmm.
And this has really got the country turned upside down. People are struggling to maintain these relationships without being able to give the gifts that historically they gave. And so they're having to really rethink a basic part of their social interaction.
Do we have that when we get a coming together of so many different cultures that we have to be careful not to step on anybody's toes?
Oh, absolutely, because there are major cultural differences regarding some of this conduct, but part of what the Olympic Games are supposed to represent is countries coming together and competing fairly by agreed upon rules.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Olympics are about rules that transcend national and cultural differences and trying to interact with each other within those guidelines.
Mm-hmm. And then trying to find our commonalities as well.
That's exactly right. And the anti-corruption movement globally really is about commonality. We talk about corruption being cultural in some parts of the world, but I think that's actually not true. I think just about everybody in the world would believe that bribery is a bad thing. And so as we focus on the corruption that's occurring in the Olympics and we try to deter that corruption, we really are affirming a global value, a value of transparency, accountability, of fairness. And it's what the Olympics were designed to do, to promote global values.
Mm-hmm. This isn't necessarily corruption, but sometimes stories overshadow the games themselves.
Yes.
And of course, we've got the story of Dr. Larry Nassar, who was convicted and sentenced recently for sexually abusing some of the gymnastics members.
Right.
Do you think a story like that will overshadow the games, or is that kind of behind us now?
Well, it may not overshadow the games, but I hope it's discussed in context of the games, because I think it actually is corruption. It's an example of someone abusing their authority for private gain. It's an example of organizations failing to detect and prevent this conduct. And so I think it's appropriate that we talk about Larry Nassar and recognize we're at this turning point now culturally where we're realizing that organizations like the United States Olympic Committee, like the International Olympic Committee, like USA Gymnastics, have to put programs in place, policies and procedures in place to detect and prevent and to punish misconduct like this. Nassar has brought this issue to the fore, and it's going to be a catalyst, I think, to reforms.
And is that what a lot of your study is for, to push for reform?
Absolutely, because there's this emerging global consensus that corruption is harmful. We see these corruption scandals that damage the Olympic brand and are just generally discouraging and elicit cynicism. And so it's imperative that the Olympics adopt these reforms. There's some indication that they want to adopt reforms, but there's room for some innovation and some ideas, to some suggestions, and those are what we work on.
Well, we mentioned that you're going to South Korea next week for work.
That's
are
right.
You going to enjoy some of the games as well?
How could I not? The Olympic atmosphere is going to be thick, and yeah, so the students and I are going to present our research at a conference and do a workshop at a law school. We'll also probably get in a couple of Olympic events.
All right. Well, thank you so much for coming to talk to us. A very interesting subject.
Thank you very much.
You're
great
very welcome. Professor Andy Spaulding from the University of Richmond. If you'd like to know more about Andy's research on anti-corruption law in the Olympics, we'll post a link on our website. Just go to WTVR.com/VTM by early this afternoon. Thank you once again.
Thank you.